Our next guest has spent a lifetime bringing those charged with the worst human rights abuses to justice. Joining us now to discuss his work pursuing some of the world's worst despots, here's Reed Brody. He is counsel and spokesperson for Human Rights Watch. And it's good to have you here in Toronto.
Thank you very much.
Where's home for you?
Brooklyn, New York.
Brooklyn,
although
New York.
I've lived everywhere in the world, but I just moved back to right near where I was born in Brooklyn.
Well, I don't know if they called you this on the streets of Brooklyn, but I have certainly seen references in some of the world's bigger media to you being called the Dictator Hunter. Why do they call you that?
Well, I've spent my career, at least the last 15 years of it, working with victims who are trying to bring the perpetrators of atrocities, the people who tortured them or who laid waste to their country, helping them bring the perpetrators to justice. And it really began, or this phase of my work began in 1998 with the case of Augusto Pinochet, the former dictator of Chile. And in October 98, he was arrested in London on a warrant from a Spanish judge for crimes allegedly committed in Chile.
Back in the 1970s.
Back in the 1970s, exactly. And when he was arrested, I went to London. He challenged his arrest before the British courts, went up to the Judicial Committee of the House of Lords. And we participated in the case. And when the House of Lords ruled that Pinochet's arrest could go forward, that he didn't have immunity, we realized that we had a tool in international justice to bring to book tyrants and torturers who seemed out of the reach of justice.
And that tool, until that moment, was not there?
The law was there, but it had never been put into practice. And, you know, it's one thing to have these things on the books, and there were many cases in which it could have happened, but it took the Pinochet case and the political will in England at the time and Spain to make it happen.
How much of a watershed case was that in terms of your overall attempts to bring justice to those who had suffered at the hands of some of the world's worst despots?
Well, it was, I mean, everything that I do now flows from that case. At the time, I famously said that the House of Lords decision was a wake-up call for dictators. But what it really was an inspiration for human rights groups and for victims around the world. And so while Pinochet was under house arrest in London, we started getting emails and calls from, what about Suharto, and what about Straussner, and what about so-and-so? We've taken up a number of those cases, and some have gone forward and some have not. But it's really that Pinochet case was an inspiration to victims around the world.
I'm going to pick up on some of those cases, but before we do, one last question on Pinochet. I guess sometimes when you do your work, you will get the reaction from some people around the world that, hey, this is a doddering old man now, and what are you picking on him for? All the stuff he did is 30 years in the rearview mirror. What's the argument against those people?
Well, you know, the time of justice and the time of human beings is not the same, said Seneca. And what happens is that it takes so long sometimes. I mean, these cases, in the case of Pinochet and the cases we're going to talk about, victims have been fighting for 20, 25, 30 years. And the desire for justice does not go away. And it, unfortunately, as you say, by the time justice often catches up to people, either it's too late because they're dead, or they're so old that they evoke sympathy. But obviously, and there's a point at which somebody is too old to stand trial, but normally justice should be done and the victim should recover their dignity.
Let's pluck another name out of the headline, shall we? Hissène Habré. Who's that?
Hissène Habré was the dictator of Chad in the 1980s. He was put into power by Ronald Reagan. It was the first covert operation of the Reagan era as a bulwark against Muammar Gaddafi. He turned his country into a police state. A truth commission accused him of 40,000 political killings. When he was overthrown, he fled to Senegal. And it was precisely during Pinochet's house arrest in London that the head of the Chadian Human Rights Association came to see me and said, well, we have a Pinochet here. We have somebody who's alleged to have committed many more crimes than Pinochet. Can you help us? And so we've been working side by side with the Chadian victims groups and the Chadian activists for the last 15 years. And finally, last year, Senegal, where he lives in exile, and the African Union established a special court To prosecute the crimes of the Habré era. And he is now in jail awaiting trial next year.
In Senegal?
In Senegal, yes.
Look at the monitor over my shoulder, if you would. We're going to put some video up right now of, this is, I gather, you in Chad. And why don't you just walk us through this and tell us what we're seeing?
Well, we had fought to be able to look at some of Habré's prisons and his administrative buildings. And this building was the house of his political police, the DDS. And my colleague and I stumbled. Nobody knew that this building contained room after room of documents of the DDS, spying reports, daily lists of people who died in detention, tens of thousands of documents that provide actually a roadmap to how the repression was carried out. Just in these documents, which the Victims Association then filed and collated and copied, there are the names of 1,208 people who died in detention, of 12,300 and something people who were arbitrarily arrested. So they form the backbone, together with victims' testimony and people around Habré, of the legal case against the former dictator.
Can you explain to us why any perpetrator of mass human rights abuses meticulously documents what they do? What's the point of that?
Well, you know, we see the same thing with whether it's the Stasi or the Derg in Ethiopia.
Nazi Germany.
Or Nazi Germany.
Going on forever.
I mean, people, this is a bureaucracy. And the bureaucrat has to say to the bureaucrat above him, this is what we did. They had a daily list of people in prison. Today, two people were arrested, one person died, next day, and they have the names. And, this is an incredibly well-documented a case. And, you know, when Habré fled, he thought well enough to empty out his country's treasury and bring that money with him to Senegal, which is how he's managed to evade justice for so long. But I guess they didn't think of cleaning up that building.
Why did the Senegalese agree to cooperate with your efforts?
Well, it took a long time. Habré was first arrested. We helped the victims from Chad file a case in Senegal, and he was first arrested in 2000. But for the next 12 years, the Senegalese government refused to move forward. And it was only after the International Court of Justice, in a case brought by Belgium, ruled that Senegal had to prosecute him. And then a new president was elected in Senegal. And we've spent the last 15 years bringing the victims from Chad to Senegal, because people in Senegal have no more idea of who Hissène Habré is than people in Canada do. Mm-hmm. And so the victims have been going and talking to people and talking to the politicians. And finally, when Macky Sall became president, he said, look, we have to do right by the victims, and we have to organize a fair trial for Hissène Habré. And this will be the first time that the courts of one African country prosecute crimes committed in another African country. And in fact, it'll be the first time anywhere in the world that the courts of one country prosecute alleged human rights crimes of somebody in another country. So Senegal is really a leader in this. And you know, it's gratifying to finally work with an administration that wants to move forward and do the right thing.
Well, given that the crimes didn't happen, though, in Senegal, do you expect Habré to argue that this court has no jurisdiction to go after me in this way?
Well, the first, you know, whether it's Milosevic or the Nazis or anybody, the first line of defense is always to attack the legitimacy of the court. Mm-hmm. And Habré is doing that. Habré does not cooperate with the court. He says it's an illegitimate court. It was established for political reasons. He blames the current government of Chad. He blames the West. He blames Libya. He blames France. But I think, you know, this is going to be a televised trial, and hopefully the world will see that the evidence is very strong, and really that this is a case in which the victims will participate as civil parties under the French system. So the victims' lawyers will be leading the examination, and I look forward to the moment when people back in Chad watch on their TV and see Chadian lawyers, including one who was almost assassinated by one of Habré's accomplices, a very brave woman named Jacqueline Mudena, when they watch those people lead the case and cross-examine a man who used to be their dictator, I think has a very powerful potential to show that victims with tenacity and perseverance and imagination can bring a dictator to justice.
When do you think the trial will start?
It's supposed to start May of next year, May 2015.
Okay. You missed your chance to get baby doc, right? Jean-Claude Duvalier, the former Haitian dictator, just died. Tell us about him and why he would have been on your list.
Well, he was. I mean, the Duvalier was, baby doc took over from his father, Papa Doc Duvalier. He ruled the country for 15 years until he fled in 1986. His government had what's called a triangle of death, three prisons where countless prisoners died of malnutrition and of torture. Very surprisingly, he came back to the country 3 years ago. And the then government of Haiti, the government of René Préval, actually asked us to come in and help them build the case against Baby Doc, and we did. But then when the Martelly, when President Michel Martelly was elected, the political will shifted. But we continued to work on the case with the victims. And actually, I have to say, the Haitian courts, it took a while, but earlier this year, an appeals court ruled that Duvalier had to could stand trial, that the statute of limitations could not apply to crimes against humanity, that even though he didn't commit the crimes personally, that his command responsibility could be invoked. Unfortunately, he died. Unfortunately, I say, because it could have been for Haiti the trial of the century. And in a country where, particularly Haiti is a country that I know quite well, where really the law has always protected a small elite and never really served to benefit the great mass of citizens. This could have been a case to show Haitians that justice can work, even for the poor and even against powerful people. And earlier, last year, actually, Duvalier was forced into court. He had to answer charges, sit there. And I think Haitians, just watching that on TV, just seeing this man who used to be the dictator, have to listen to the charges, have to answer questions about his police and the Tonton Macoutes. I think it was very important for Haiti.
Why does a guy who has escaped justice from his own country return to his own country, knowing for sure someone's going to want to take a shot at him or get him arrested or put him on trial or whatever?
We don't know. I mean, we believe that, you know, when he left the country, he took allegedly between $400 and $900 million with him, and he went through it. And there was $6 million left that was being impounded in Switzerland. And we believe that he came in because he felt that he had to show the Swiss, in order to get his money back, that he could live in Haiti and not be pursued. And he felt the Haitian justice system had been so degraded that he could get away with it. But fortunately, there were very brave former victims, people like Bobby Duval, who watched hundreds of people die in Fort Dimanche prison in front of him, people like Michel Montas, who said, "We are not going to let fear rule our country." And they brought the case. And you know, that's the wonderful part about all these stories, is that there are victims, people who have decided to transform their suffering into a campaign for justice. And I get to work with these people, so.
Well, let me put another argument to you, and you tell me what you think about this, because in a couple of the countries that we've talked about here, Chad and Haiti, two, if I can put it this way, dirt poor, godforsaken, misbegotten countries where there is so much, you know, there's just so much to do to make these normal countries. Do you fear that that too many resources are being put towards bringing these admittedly awful people towards justice at the expense of, and that's the question, I mean, at the expense of other needs that these countries surely have as well?
Sure. I mean, I think that's a really important question, because I think particularly in the case of Haiti, the attitude of many outsiders is, well, you know, if these people can eat, that's, you know, they should be happy. And I think people fail to see the connection between the lack of justice and you know, the alienation of such great parts of society. I mean, you know, we are actually the West, and I should say that Canada is the only country that called for the prosecution of Duvalier. The United States did not, France did not, others did not. Precisely because, you know, my God, if, you know, with all the problems Haiti has. But I think that that's a short-sighted way of looking at it. This is the kind of a case that could kickstart confidence that the state, you know, can serve Haitians. And I think that the marginalization of Haitian people, the fact that the justice system has never spoken on behalf of the poor, is part of the problem. I mean, there's a direct relation, as I see it, between the lack of justice and the democratic accountability that is required in order to make inroads into poverty.
Now, when countries can't do what you want them to do, namely pursue dictators and get justice for them, I gather the International Criminal Court is supposed to step in and do that job. How well do you think they do that job?
I think the International Criminal Court has, you know, it's a young institution. We look around some of the signature atrocities of our time. Darfur, the president of Sudan, is wanted. Côte d'Ivoire, the former president, Laurent Gbagbo, is sitting in the dock. The problem with the International Criminal Court is, first of all, it doesn't have a police force, so it can't enforce its writ. The president of Sudan gallivants around to countries that he wants to. And second, that it only has jurisdiction where countries have either ratified the treaty or the case is sent to them by the Security Council. Which means that countries like the United States, Russia, and China in particular, which both sit on the Security Council and have not ratified the treaty, are exempt from the court.
You know why?
Well, because they're the big boys and they don't see the
need.
Well,
no, because they're afraid that somebody from the criminal court's going to get a wise idea to go say, let's arrest George W. Bush or Tony Blair, and they're not interested in seeing that happen.
But you know, it's very hard to ask others to do what you will not do yourself. Mm-hmm. I mean, Human Rights Watch, I wrote a report for Human Rights Watch called Getting Away with Torture that examines the policies of the Bush administration during the war on terror and says, there is a case to answer for George Bush, Dick Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, George Tenet for war crimes and torture. And George Bush admitted that he ordered the waterboarding or agreed with the waterboarding of people. We know, I mean, Maher Arar, a Canadian citizen, yep, who was sent by the United States to Syria where he was savagely tortured, to Assad's Syria. Mm. People who were sent, my colleagues in Tripoli after the fall of Gaddafi, found in the security services headquarters files where the U.S. was sending people to Gaddafi to be interrogated with the questions that should be given. Now, this is torture. And I'm not comparing Guantanamo and Darfur, but if we say, if Americans can exempt themselves from the justice system, it makes it much more difficult to apply that justice system elsewhere.
No, I hear you, but you know, conversely, if you... One of the criticisms of the court is that if you insist on criminally prosecuting, let's take Bush and Blair out of this, just your average run-of-the-mill awful dictator, there's no incentive for them to leave power because once they do, you're going to get them. Is that a flaw in the system here?
It's not a flaw. I think it's a consideration. I don't think we can just say, you know, if the ANC had insisted that the apartheid leaders of South Africa be prosecuted, the transition in South Africa would not have gone as quickly or as smoothly as it did. But I think the argument tends to be overstated. Most of these people leave office kicking and screaming when they're being thrown out, not because they're trying to cut a deal or because they haven't cut a deal. So I think the argument tends to be overstated. I mean, Milosevic was indicted. He was the president of Serbia. People say, how can you do that? He's never going to step down. Well, he stepped down and he went to The Hague. Mm-hmm. Charles Taylor was indicted when he was the president of Liberia. He stepped down, he went to a special court and has been prosecuted. So I think, you know, we can't ignore the argument, would be foolish to, but I think we have to only give it the credence that it deserves.
I got 20 seconds left. Who's next on your list?
I think there, you know, you look out there are people like Mengistu of Ethiopia, who's living in Zimbabwe. I would like to see, frankly, a case brought against George Bush. I think that would serve to balance the scales of justice and to show that even the powerful leaders of democratic countries have to be held to account.
Reed Brody, it's good of you to come into TVO and share your views with us tonight. Thanks so much.
You're quite welcome.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.